From Jackie Jones Shire Studio in beautiful CCM at the University of Cincinnati, it's the Dennis Daniel Show! Tonight's guest, voice actress Karen Strassman. And now, here is your host. He is the 2009 Bearcast Innovator of the Year, Boogaloo Shrimp, Dennis Daniel!
Hit this smell! What the rock is cooking?
Gentlemen, boys and girls, and children of all ages, you have successfully navigated yourself to BearcastRadio.com's hottest wrestling, anime, comedy, action, drama, slasher, gothic, independent film movie show, The Dennis Daniel Show. Okay, so we're not a movie show, but we've had people on the show who have been in movies. I am your host, the leader of the All Taste Nation, and BearcastRadio.com's Innovator of the Year for 2009, Dennis Daniel. Anyway, folks, I bet you're wondering where he is. You know, he's the CC to my Kallen Stadtfeld. I know, it's a great reference. John Pokemon, again, could not be here with us because he has to work. I guess he'd rather work than interview voice actors and actresses. I have no idea why not, but... But hopefully he'll be back this summer, a brand new season, season 13 of the All Taste Explosion. This summer on BearcastRadio.com, we're getting ready to make the big jump to BlogTalkRadio.com, and I am just excited, folks. But anywho, I'll tell you why I'm excited tonight. Because tonight on the show, we have got none other than voice actress Karen Strassman. That's right, Karen Strassman. For those of you who have no idea who in the world Karen Strassman is, well, then you're not looking hard enough, my friends, because Karen Strassman, she is the deal. And I am not just making that up. No, she has been in a lot of good shows, you know, a lot of good ones, you know, some are a mixed bag, you know, some, you know, but whenever she's in something, you know, it's going to be good. She's probably best known as Kallen Stadtfeld from the hit show Code Geass. And that reminds me of a little joke I made. I got a joke here. It's a really, really funny joke. y'all know those Jeff Foxworthy, you might be a redneck jokes? Well, I did a anime version of you might be an otaku. So, and I've done a list of these, and I'm testing them out. And I've gone to different conventions, and I've seen all these fans, and you know, I developed this test to find out whether or not you are an otaku. So here's the one that made me think of Karen. If you think CC from Code Geass owns that nationwide pizza buffet, you might be an otaku. That's a good joke. That was funny. I got other ones. I actually got some other ones. If you own a Sailor Moon credit card, if you thought the fighting in Egypt could be solved by playing Yu-Gi-Oh, if the name Howl's Moving Castle is what you use to describe your mobile home, well, you might be a redneck, but you might be an otaku. Again, these are hit and misses, you know, folks. You know, I'm one man. I'm trying to do the very best I got here. Hang on. I'm receiving some late breaking news. Yeah, I'm gonna be late. Yeah, I'm receiving some breaking news. It has been announced by the Britannian government that Ashford Academy student Kallen Stadtfeld is believed to have ties with the radical group, the Black Knights. The Black Knights, led by their mysterious and masked leader Zero, have made it their sole mission to overthrow the Britannian Empire. Again, Britannian government has just announced that Ashford Academy student Kallen Stadtfeld is believed to have ties with the radical Black Knights. Wait, I'm being interrupted for breaking news. You can't interrupt me for breaking news. It's my show. Get rid of that. Jeez. Next thing you know, I'm going to be interrupted by the anonymous Raw general manager. But anyway, back to Karen Strassman. Back to Karen Strassman. I'll tell you what, she's had some Cracker Jack rules. Another one of my personal favorites, Yuzuki from Chobits. That's right, she was in Chobits. She was Yuzuki. She was that long blue-haired maid. I'll tell you what, I did not know she was a robot android cyborg. And if you like Wendy Lee in Lucky Star, you should love Karen too, because she's Miyuki-san. You know, she's full of those moe points. Clumsy is sexy, my friends. Here I am doing a wolf whistle to a high school student. Man, that is pretty sad. She's been in so many wonderful roles, and I can't do her justice by talking about it. So I have comprised, like for most of my guests, a demo reel, if you will. Yeah, that's right. I've got a demo reel featuring some of her, you know, some of her best known roles. And so while we have a minute, let's check it out.
I'm so sorry.
What the hell does that mean? There's no need to apologize. It's either right or wrong. You think you can flip out the good guy routine whenever you like? Not when I'm this pissed off. Kallen Koski's a soldier, not a sideshow. I'm mostly pissed off because you're not resisting. There. Put me to death. An inmate assaulting a knight of the round should be good reason enough for anyone.
No, I won't. Because I'm the one who did wrong.
No, I won't. I hate you!
Oh, well, if I start explaining it, we could be here for quite a while. Well, let's just say the term is Chinese and leave it at that, shall we?
Okay, all those who just thought of something X-rated, raise your hands.
Come to think of it, my mother's the same way.
Hey, Miyuki, would you like to watch this movie with me tonight? I'm too scared to watch it alone.
I heard that people who scare easily tend to watch lots of movies of that sort. Perhaps they secretly like it.
No, Yuki-chan, you're wrong. I really, really hate horror movies, really.
Would you like me to give it a try?
Oh. Yuzuki.
Please excuse us. My name is Hideki Motosuwa.
Welcome to our home. How do you do? My name is Yuzuki.
So you would be Mr. Kokobunji's elder sister?
Oh, no. I'm a Persicom who was custom-built by Lord Minoru. Lord Minoru?
But...
You are curious to find out her capabilities, right?
586,920 hours, 37 minutes since we met, Shinku. I was unaware that you had awakened.
Really?
I thought I had made it known. Did you not see the signs? So, that was you. The poor little doll was acting under your influence.
Just my way of saying hello.
By the way, if you've been defeated in the game, what are you still doing here, Hina Ichigo? A doll that's lost the game must surrender her Rosa Mystica to the one who has beaten her. Those are the rules of the Alice game. Why have you defied such simple rules?
Mind your business. I have my own way of doing things.
Even if you should anger Father?
Indeed. Good afternoon, passengers, and welcome aboard the SS Seeker. We'd like to make a special announcement reminding you that we're on a mission.
Pardon me, but I don't recall Guggenheim telling us that having no fun at all was part of our mission.
You don't see pros like myself and Dante goofing off now, do you?
Yeah!
What was that you were saying about pros, Zalia?
I'm not talking to you.
Well, let me ask you a question before you sit down. Do you have enough strength left to tell me the basis for the ruling in the 1968 Stuttgart case?
Oh, yes. Well, the defense claimed that the kidnapping was a sham, and that the victim's death had been due to poisoning. After an investigation into the crime scene, it was found that the victim's death had been accidental, and that there was no motive. So, since the crime couldn't be proven to be an intentional murder, I believe a sentence of 15 years was handed down.
Oh, wow. Mm. Very good. You can take your seat, Nina Fortuna.
That is a demo reel of epicness. And I am trying to keep with every fiber of my being from making a Rent joke about when she was Suiginto and she said the number of hours since they met. Because you could do like, how do you measure? Measure a year in heartbeats. And that. It's a Rent joke in an anime interview. I get it. But folks, we have had a great week. Bin Laden is dead. The Rock celebrated his birthday. It was a media extravaganza. And Karen Strassman's on the Dennis Daniels Show. It is a good time to be an American. So without further ado, let's get right down to the nitty gritty. My next guest is a very critically acclaimed voice actress. She's best known as Kallen Stadtfeld from Code Geass, Yuzuki from Chobits, Suiginto from Rosen Maiden. And of course, she's also been in a lot of new stuff, like Huntik, Secrets and Seekers as Zalia Moon. And of course, she's also the new voice of Rouge the Bat in the Sonic the Hedgehog franchise. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is, without further ado, that I give you, she is the one, the only, Mrs. Karen Strassman! Ms. Strassman, thank you, and welcome to the Dennis Daniels Show.
Hey, Dennis.
How you doing?
Good. Can I just sit down here on the couch next to you?
Sure. Why not? Let's go right ahead. We're breaking the fourth wall, ladies and gentlemen.
Move over. Let me sit a little closer. Is that okay?
That's great. That's more than okay. That's fantastic. Fantastic. That's some crazy stuff going on. Well, I can't believe we jumped through all of these hoops, and finally we're here. You know, we got the interview. We're going right now. We're quad winning, which is four times the winning that Charlie Sheen is winning. So there we go. A winning Charlie Sheen joke in the show. So let's get that out of the way. So again, I thank you so much, and I gotta say it's an honor. You're in a lot of shows that I've watched, whether it was Yuzuki and Chobits or Miyuki-san and Lucky Star, because we just had Wendy Lee on the show, and of course they have nothing but positive things to say about you.
Well, it's mutual.
Well, I guess a great place to start would be, what got you interested in voice acting?
Well, first, Dennis, I gotta say that voice reel you made is just fantastic. I mean, you picked out some of my very favorite roles in there, and that's a lot of work to put something like that together, and I just thought that was fantastic, and I just wanted to say how cool that was and how much I appreciate it.
Well, it's much preachified. It's hard to find these things on YouTube in English because everyone's taking them down because of copyright infringement.
Yeah.
Now, for the record, I do not keep the episodes. I just extract the audio, delete the video, and then make the demo reel. And this is the third one I've made. I've made one for Rebecca Forstadt and one for Richard Epcar. And I figure that's something we should start doing now, you know, to get the guests warmed up, to familiarize them with the guests.
It's really cool. I was just sitting back and listening to it, you know, and you hear all these, you know, these voices that are just, you know, I was listening to him going, God, I love some of these characters. You know, they're just dear friends of mine, all these characters that live inside.
Well, hey, some of them friends, I like to, like some of my friends too. And some of them I want to stay 50 feet away from.
Yeah. Anyway, I digress. You asked me what got me started in voiceover, right?
Yep.
It was never anything that I planned to do. When I was a student, I moved to France, and I was going to study there for a year, and I just started getting work. I started working as a dialect coach, and then I started working on movie sets as an actress, and somehow one thing led to another, and I just fell into doing voiceover over there. And I started dubbing movies. I started dubbing original, you know, animation and original animation. And they have video games over there. And in Europe, you know, they like to do a certain number of things in English because it sort of sells well all over the world. And I just fell into it. And I guess I was good at it because one job led to another and led to another. I mean, there are some things over there that I did very early on, like Dune, the video game Dune, which was, I think, one of the first video games that was mocapped, if I can recall. But I was over there for, 16 years or something, doing all kinds of films, all kinds of stuff. And I was the voice of the channel, the train between Paris and London. And I was the voice of Disneyland Paris. I was the voice of the Musée d'Orsay and the Louvre. You know, they have those guided tours, and I was one of those voices. And I just got to do a lot of fun stuff, and I got to do all kinds of different stuff. And so I never even took classes. That's just kind of where I got my training. And then I moved to the States. And because I'd been doing it for so long, I had a lot of introductions, and I just fell into doing it here. And I just feel like the luckiest person on earth. You know, I was jumping around from job to job today, and you know, this has been years and years since I've been going into studios and doing this, and every single time I do it, you know, with the exception of sometimes you have a bad day or you're feeling sick or, you know, you have some people who have some bad energy, but with those exceptions, it's just like every single day, it's just like walking into a, it's like walking into a amusement park and getting to play. And I just feel like I'm really, really lucky.
Yes, I believe it was Rebecca that said in our interview with her that everybody has a different way of how they've gotten into the voice acting industry. And to get into it and not have any professional background education, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it was pretty, I don't even think I thought about it existing before I fell into it. I think the very first voiceover I did was way back when CDs didn't even exist. And people were still listening to vinyl and cassettes. And there was a magazine in France called Hi Kids. And I'm sure if somebody gets on their computer, you can probably look it up and find it somehow. But this is like 24 years ago. And this was this magazine for kids in France called Hi Kids. And it was to introduce, you know, 10-year-olds and, you know, that age range, 9, 10, 11, to English. And so I was teaching theater classes for French children and teaching them to act in English. And these gals who were creating this project came in and saw us teaching it, and they saw us having so much fun, and they just said, would you come and record for us for these, you know, we'll hire you and pay you to record for our magazine. And we recorded all kinds of stories, and I'd never done this before. I mean, I've been acting all my life because acting since I was just a little kid has always been my passion. It's always been what I wanted to do. And we just went to the studio, and she just threw roles at me, and I had no idea what was going to come out of my mouth, and I just started playing. And that's where I got my training, was just doing the stuff, you know? And I got in France, I got to do some really fun things. I don't know if you all remember the movie French Kiss, starring Meg Ryan and Kevin Kline. But when that came to France, I dubbed it into France. But for Meg Ryan, they wanted her to have an American accent. So I dubbed Meg Ryan into French, and I did her voice speaking in an American accent in French. So to this day, if you go to French movie theaters and you want to watch or, you know, get the cassette and you want to see that, you know, you'll hear her speaking French, and that's me. All kinds of cool stuff like that.
I would not even begin to comprehend how Meg Ryan would sound French with an American thing. I would not be able to even comprehend that with 95% of my brain. Now, I recently read in an article that you started in the industry at the young age of 21.
Yeah.
And have you noticed any changes in the industry from since when you started?
You know, it's really hard to say because, like, the first 15 years that I was in the business, I was really living in Paris for those 15 years. Really, so until the age of, 35, 36. And so I wasn't in the industry in America all the way through, so I had a very different experience because I was working in Europe. I mean, you know, there's a very big difference in the fact that, you know, we were recording, you know, like when I first started recording, they were, you know, recording on literal tape. And they, you know, to cut the tape, they'd be cutting ribbons on the cutting room floor. I remember when I did my very, very first demo, I went to this little studio in the 18th arrondissement in Paris with this great guy, and we cut my first demo out of all these samples of stuff I'd done, and there was just ribbons and ribbons piled on the studio floor, you know, and now you just touch a button and hit delete, and you've edited stuff. So I think technically there's been a huge amount of changes. Gosh, I mean, in terms of the acting, I'm sure there's different trends and everything. For me, it's just as fun as the very first day.
Yeah. Now, what do you do to prepare for a role or for an audition for a role?
That completely depends, because sometimes I'll get called for an audition, and honestly, I will have no idea what I'm called in for. My agent will send me, or I'll be called by maybe Bang Zoom will call me and say, hey, we want you to audition for something. And, or my agent will send me to a studio and say, you know, we want you to audition for this game or something. And I'll have no, or a commercial. And I will have absolutely no idea what I'm auditioning for. And I'll just walk into the studio and they'll hand me the sides. And I'll look down and I'll go, oh, okay. Oh, so they want a Russian accent. All right. Or, you know, oh, okay, so she's 14. Okay. If I get the sides ahead of time, you know, I'll kind of play around with it. And if there's pictures, I like to look at the pictures and, you know, kind of feel what the character feels like. Pictures always help a lot, you know. If I have time, I'll play with it at home. And if not, I just walk into the studio and, you know, work with whoever's running the cast and going, all right, here's an idea I had. What do you think? You know, maybe she should sound like that. Is that too sexy or is that too old or young? And I'll say, yeah. Maybe make her voice a little slower, maybe make her a little younger, or, you know, and we'll just kind of play with it together, you know? I think at that stage, it's kind of like you're molding it. You're trying to figure it out and working sort of collaboratively to see, you know?
Yeah, I understand. It's like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get.
Yeah.
We make that reference way too much on this show. I have no idea why, but we just make too much. I don't know. Which voice actors do you work with frequently, and how do you get along with your peers in the industry?
Well, we don't always get to work together because the nature of what we do more often than not for most projects we do is that we go in and we just record alone with the directors and, you know, sometimes the clients. You know, and we don't usually get to record with our peers. So most oftentimes we see our peers when we're, you know, crossing paths in the studio. And in terms of how I get along with them, God, Dennis, I think that most, you know, 98% of the people in the voice industry are the most lovely, fun-loving, generous people who kind of have life in perspective. You know, because it's, we all know that it's not brain surgery, and we all know that, you know, we're not saving lives, and, you know, we're here to entertain people, and so our job is to have fun, you know? We're here to put out good vibes and have fun, so our job is to have fun together, and I can't tell you how many people have called me and gone, oh, Karen, you know, I just did this audition, but I think you might be good for it, why don't you go in, and I'll do that same thing with friends. And we're just, you know, there's more of a sense than not a family. And it's just always such a joy to see people. I mean, I just, for example, today I was just working with Stephanie Shea because she's directing Huntick right now. And I just did a 3-hour session with her. And, you know, we try and be as efficient as we can and get work done. But we spend a lot of time gabbing because it's just fun to be with each other, you know. And then I went to another studio to audition for a project that I can't talk about yet. But I saw Kirk Thornton in the parking lot, and we gave each other a big hug and gabbed for a while. And then when I went into this audition, I saw Chris Smith, who was auditioning, and we gave each other a big hug and gabbed for a while and talked about how his son is doing and all that. Then I saw Keith Silverstein, who was auditioning. We gave each other a big hug and talked about his son. And then Doug Erholtz was there, and we said hello. And I have been hearing Doug's voice all over town for years, and we have never met. We met for the first time, like 2 days ago. And there's some people like that. You just hear their voice all over town, and you just one day you meet. And it's just it's really fun that way. So even if we don't always get to work together, it's just such a delight. There's one project I've been working on called Pom Pom for younger children, and we get to record all together in the studio. And Michelle Ruff and Dorothy Fawn and Chris Smith and Mona Marshall are on that with me. And we're all in the studio together, and we just have such a fun time. And we're all doing voices of little kids. And it's just, Renee Veilleux is directing it. And it's just like whenever we have a studio session, it's like going to a party or going to lunch with your best friends or something, you know, and we might not have the time to see each other outside the session, but we all get there and we're just so happy to be there, you know? So there's just a long-winded answer to your question. You just interrupt me if I talk too much.
No. Mom always taught me never interrupt someone when they're talking. That's a rule. That's a rule we follow here on Bearcast. We give the guests the time that they want to talk, because we want to make them feel comfortable. That's the thing. But with guys like Kyle Aber and Wendy Lee and Crispin Freeman, mm-hmm. and you know, it sounds like you guys are a pretty good niche going on. And I like that. I like it. I might have to get into this voice acting pie too.
You'd be great at it.
I would get nervous because, you know, I know you're thinking, yeah, because you're doing a radio thing and you're behind a mic behind a secluded area. And that's similar voice. Like, no, it's not, because I saw Wendy Lee's voice acting panel at ANG Ohio, and I wanted to do it, but I was scared I would have screwed up, and it would have just been. And I'm stuck in pubescent teenage boy mode for some reason, and I can't get out of it.
That's good for anime, though. That's perfect.
You know, you are not the first person to say that. Well, I mean, since you kind of transitioned into it, can you tell us a little bit about Huntic Secrets and Seekers? It's a new show on the four kids, Toon's Eye, and what's it about, and how's it coming along?
Well, Huntic is about my character, her name is Zalia, and she is one of my favorite characters I played in a long time. She is hot and sexy, and she has this very dark side to her, but the other side to her, she wants to be a good guy. And in the first season, she was a bad guy, and she transitioned over to this group, the good guys, and who, you know, they all have these special powers that they work with, and now they're all working for good. But she still has this dark side to her and this very dark past and this troubled past. And she is sexy and tough. And it's a really fun show, you know. And it kind of straddles the world of, you know, sort of Yu-Gi-Oh! Meets, you know, Saturday morning cartoon animation. It's part anime, but it's really very Saturday morning animation. And it's really, really a fun show.
It's funny you mentioned Yu-Gi-Oh! Because we had Eric Stewart on the show, and before his before he came out, he kind of stomped my ass by doing Kaiba. So it's kind of a rule here on the show that I at least get my ass kicked by one cartoon character. That's kind of a given. It started with Pat Fraley, who did Krang, then Eric Stewart did Kaiba, then Winnie Lee did Konata, and it's been a very, very, very messed up tradition here. her name's Zalia Moon. That's a fancy name.
Yeah, Zalia Moon, and she talks right down here, and you don't mess with her. She's got these hot boots. I mean, she's pretty hot.
Well, you gotta watch these magic kids. You know, if they get out of line, you're gonna have to kick their ass. I don't know. I am messing with that Harry Potter nonsense. BearcastRadio.com. This is the Dennis Daniels Show. We got Karen Strassman on the air. Now, which of the characters that you have done best reflects your own personality or something about you that you like?
Wow. Gosh. I think there's so many different characters that reflect different parts of my personality. Gosh. I love, that's so hard. There's so many different ones.
We can come back to it.
I love the struggle of Nina on Monster. I mean, I wouldn't say that I am Nina from Monster. But, you know, I think I wouldn't say that I'm like her, but she is one of the favorite characters I have ever played. You know, she's just struggling with her identity, and she's just such a real, you know, it's really like acting for live action when we did Nina, you know? It's not that over-the-top anime, but it's so real. And I think, like, so much of Monster is just, like, chilling, you know? And she's struggling for her identity and for her life. And she's one of my favorite characters, I think. I think that's one of my favorite shows I've ever done. In terms of characters that are similar to me, I love Momo Hinamori from Bleach. I love her strength and her soulfulness. And her desire to do good. I think that, you know, and it's her downfall because she wants to be so faithful to people and she wants to do good and it ends up being her downfall and I can relate to that. I can very much relate to Miyuki from Lucky Star. She's one of my favorite characters too. Because she's smart, but she's clumsy and she gives these long-winded explanations for things. I can very much relate to that.
It's not clumsy, it's Moe! Again, we're going to the record. Clumsy equals sexy. I don't know why. I honestly do not know why. I mean, it's cute, but you feel bad at the end. It's like kicking a puppy. You get that thrill, but when the puppy lands, you feel bad. I got a real unique machinations in the old noggin, so I have no idea where that. It's funny, reminding me, Miyuki. We got a question for a voice request, but we'll come back to that later on in the show. It's funny. We've been doing that. We did this when Wendy was on, so we'll deal with it. But moving right along, do you think that anime is prejudiced or sexist in the sense of how it sometimes portrays some of its female characters?
Oh gosh, you know, I just don't really worry about that or think about that. I mean, I guess somebody who's, you know, a full-fledged feminist could, you know, have a long-winded monologue about that. I don't really think about it. I just think it's fun. You know, of course, sure, some of them are sexist, and there's boobs, and there's, you know, light-headed, booby women, or I don't know. You know, and then there's tons of women who are kick-ass. I mean, there's Soifon. Soifon is like, she's kick-ass, you know. Then there's some real, real tough anime characters. You know, Queen Delphine from The Last Exile is pretty tough. You know, a lot of characters I do in video games, you know, they're pretty tough. I don't know. I mean, I think that people could get into a whole conversation about that. But for me, I just think that anime is fun. And I think that there's lots of fun characters. And I think you can find all different kinds of colors and shapes and sizes. You know? And, you know, I think it's fun to do a spacey, pink-haired woman from time to time. That's fun! You know? So, I don't know if that answers your question, but that's my opinion.
No, it's not my question. It's a listener question. I'm not going to say who, because it's a weird question, and I don't want them to feel odded out. Now, we talk with this a lot about with our guests. It's the effects of piracy in the anime industry, and we like to get our guests' opinion on it. How has it affected the many shows that you get to be a part of, or how many you get to audition for?
Well, basically, there's just less anime being recorded now. It's really that simple because of all this. The problem is because of all the piracy, The companies aren't making money, and there's companies that had to fold, there's companies that had to stop doing it, and most of us just don't do that much anime anymore because companies can't afford it. I spend much more of my time now doing video games and, you know, the odd anime here and there, you know? And it's a real shame. It's just too bad. And I think it's sort of ironic because, you know, the piracy is coming from the fans because they love the anime so much that they want to watch it and listen to it. And I don't think there's any conscious bad or evil intention. I think it's unconscious. I think people don't realize that through all the piracy, they're actually putting an end to the thing that they enjoy so much. And I just think we need to bring some consciousness to it across the board. You know, if you pay for your anime, then we can make more for you. If you don't, then it's just going to become a thing of the past.
Yes, and if you don't think they're cracking down, they are cracking down.
Yeah.
I recently read on Twitter or a Twitter feed that last February, Funimation had taken to court 1,336 individuals who were accused of collectively participated via the internet in the unlawful reproduction and distribution of One Piece episodes. Now, most of them have been dropped, but they can be pursued still. So I think that was the slap on the wrist saying, no, don't do it. Even find ways to get around the video distribution thing. They found websites that can download the video straight from the YouTube URL. So, guys, I'm going to say this. I've said it before. I've said it 1,000 times. Don't download anime illegally. It's like you're throwing a turd in the punch bowl that is anime, and we can't enjoy the anime punch because there's a downloading turd in it. Again, maybe not the best way to word it. I think the message is pretty clear.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right, Dennis. I mean, it's a shame because it's putting an end to the thing that people love. I mean, honestly, I used to be, you know, sometimes I'd be juggling 7 shows at the same time, you know, and running from the studio to the next, and there's just not that many out there anymore. I mean, you know, there's Bleach, which is ongoing, Naruto, and there's a couple, you know, here and there, but they're fewer and far between, and it's because of all the piracy. And, you know, if it continues, anime will be dead.
And we all pause for a 3-second shameful head shake. We're all shaking our head in shame. Well, I can't wag the finger because it's radio, so I'm just shaking the head, or I'm going to go...
Yeah, but I'm sitting next to you here on the couch.
Yeah.
Shaking your head and wagging your finger.
Yeah. I wonder if anyone's buying that on the couch thing. I wonder if anyone's buying that.
The interview couch.
Gosh, man, I want to get some chairs in here. Get some chairs. Maybe get a nice oil painting of myself. You know, that'd be nice. You know, do the place up. Maybe like Piper's Pit. That would be awesome. But anyway. So you're mostly doing video games. That's another great transition. You're also known as Helena Douglas from the Dead or Alive video game series. How'd you land that role?
That is absolutely true. I do that. Helena Douglas. They called me into audition, and I did the audition, and then they booked me the role, you know. You know, when you live in France for a long time and you speak French fluently, à ce moment-là, c'est très facile d'avoir des rôles en français. Vous voyez ce que je veux dire? You know what I mean, right?
Good. Give my regards to Glass Joe. Obscure Punch Out reference. That's we're making all kinds of great references. Wow, that was hot. That was quite hot.
Oh, and I'm very glad you liked it.
Stop. okay, hang on. I gotta calm down. Oh boy, that was okay. Okay, now we jump from Dead or Alive to your role in the new Mortal Kombat game. You play both Melina and Katana.
Oh yeah, that was fun.
Yes. And did you ever get to meet the guy that went toasty?
No. I didn't.
I have no idea what... was that. That must be some kind of Mortal Kombat reference, because I don't get it.
You know the coolest video game that I'm really, really excited about that's going to come out in a few weeks?
No, but why don't you go ahead and tell us?
Red Faction Armageddon.
Red Faction Armageddon. And I guess, well, since we're already doing a plug for it, when does it drop?
Oh, gosh. In a couple weeks. I don't know the exact date. I guess I could look it up.
To the right, Google.
If you Google Red Faction Armageddon and you Google Kara, K-A-R-A, YouTube, you can actually pull up a trailer I did just a couple weeks ago for it.
Let's go ahead and do that right now. Let's do that.
Oh, you can play it over the radio.
Yeah, I got it. I got the, let's see, Kara, K-A-R-A?
Yep.
Trailer? Okay, let's see. We've got, oh, here we go. Let's go ahead and take a quick listen. Rated M for mature.
Mars has always been dangerous. Since the terraformer was destroyed, it's only gotten worse.
Down here in Bastion, we got laws against smugglers.
But trust me, I can take care of myself.
Hey, this old arc welder still work? Guess so.
But it's good to have friends like Darius Mason. The man never looks for trouble.
Come on now, you all know me.
You're the one who unleashed hell on us all.
But it sure seems to find him. This time, the trouble runs deep.
Life forms approaching. These are non-human.
Not human.
Something's moving down here.
Deep enough to take down all of Mars. Shall we?
Hang on.
Once we clear the path, we'll need some serious firepower.
In stores, May 31st. Rated M for mature.
I think it's going to be an amazing video game. I did all the mocap for Kara.
Ooh.
I did all the motion capture for her, and I think it's, you look at the characters, and it's just so well done. I think people are really going to enjoy the game. I'm really looking forward to it coming out.
Weren't there like a whole bunch of different celebrities that were in like the various Red Faction? Or am I thinking of Red Army Faction? I think of Red Army Faction, because I could have swore. Let's see, what is this? Yep. I was thinking of another game.
Mm-hmm.
I guess, I don't know. I've never played a Red Faction game, but from what I've heard, Mars might be at stake, so... I guess maybe if they put in a downloadable content pack where you can download me and my co-host as playable characters, maybe. we're trying to get into everything, but we're not going to get into anything. But from what I hear, Karen, it sounds like a real kick-ass game that a lot of my fans should be going to pick up and playing on their different consoles, which it's going to be released to, which I don't know which ones, but it's going to be released to quite a number of them. Now, of course, aside from, from Hilaire Douglas and Melina and Kitana and Kara in the new Red Faction game, you also had the pleasure of being the new voice of Rouge or Rouge?
Rouge.
Rouge the Bat in the new Sonic Hedgehog video game series. How did you develop her character?
I saw a picture of her and a description of her, and I just sort of came up with her voice, and we were in the studio recording it with Jack Fletcher and the clients, and we just sort of honed it to what they were looking for. She's really fun. She's hot. She's the hottest bat I've ever seen.
Well, how many hot bats have you actually seen?
That's true.
Touché. It just seems. First, are the boots her feet or and I'm trying to wrap my. I mean, I've seen her plenty of times. I'm still trying to wrap my brain. Who designed her like that? That
I know.
You know, you don't see the other Sonic girls looking like that. You don't see Amy or
I know
or Cream or the female Knuckles. She looks like. And I'm going to possibly go out on a limb and say this. She looks like a prostitute. Yeah.
Who?
I said prostitute. It just she looks. She's are those boots or are those her feet? I'm looking at it right now and I'm trying to figure it out. This might be a they look like they're boots, but she doesn't look like a bat. She's got the wings, and it's. I'm trying to. Again, Dennis, you're thinking way too much into these things. So let's.
Well, when to go back to your question before, when I auditioned for them, they also, one of the directions was they were looking for sort of a Roger Rabbit, Jessica in Roger Rabbit kind of feel. So we were kind of leaning in that direction too, and she definitely sort of has that feel to her.
Yes, it's like she's the Jessica Rabbit of Sega.
Exactly.
Unless they release someone else who looks like Jessica Rabbit from Sega, and then that joke is obsolete. Now, you've done a lot of video games. How does it differ from voicing in an anime to you?
Well, voicing anime is, you know, more often than not, you know, you're doing ADR, you're dubbing it to picture in anime. So, you know, you have the picture in front of you. It's already moving. The mouth is moving. And, you know, more often than not, you have the Japanese reference. So you're trying to get very close to what already exists. Sometimes in video, there's two different kinds of video games. There's video games that might, for example, be Japanese video games. If they already have the Japanese voice and they want you to sort of match the Japanese voice. And then you might have some ADR to do and fit it into the mouth. And they'll play you the Japanese voice, and you sort of have to match the timing and match the what they did in Japan. There's another kind of family of video games that they don't have the voice yet. They don't have the voice in any language, and you are creating it. So there's no picture, you know, there's no predetermined voice. You create it, you know, from ground up, and they, you know, they tell you what they're looking for. And then you just have pages of lines in front of you and, you know, without picture, without anything, and you just create them. And you work in the studio, and the director says, you know, more like this or more aggressive or, you know, and you just create it from nothing. So that's the big difference. And the other difference is, of course, in video games, there's a lot of lines very often. You know, there's combat lines and there's efforts and there's, you know, a lot of repetitive lines because, you know, you have to say different things over and over again. So you just, instead of interacting with other characters or responding to other characters, which you do sometimes, there's a lot of lines where you're just, you know, saying that line on its own.
I'm going through the list right now. Ace Combat, 5 and 6, Armed Core 4. Baroque, Cross Edge, Crimson Gem Saga, Final Fantasy IV, you were Rosa Farrell in that one, Crystal Chronicles, Crystal Bearers, incidental characters. That's kind of a crass name. Rumble Roses 20.
Oh, yeah.
Miss Spencer, I saw a video of her. I didn't get to hear any of your audio because I guess because it was just entrances, but that seemed kind of, maybe I'm missing something here. again, Soul Calibur 4, Suikoden 5, Supreme Commander, Valkyrie Chronicles. You have been in a lot of games, and it's just...
Yeah, and there's I think, a lot that are missing from your list. Like, I did, like, at least 20 voices for EverQuest. I've done Tony Hawk's, a bunch of Tony Hawk's games. I mean, there's a lot of games that I should make sure are put on these lists that I haven't really done.
That's Wikipedia, so...
StarCraft. Yeah.
Well, Wikipedia's not perfect, so...
Yeah. We'll have to fix that.
Yeah, but again, I'm just hang on, I'm still trying to shake off Helena. That was amazing. Okay. Now, aside from doing video games and voice acting, I got a few more voice acting questions, but we'll go back to those later. You've also been casted as an extra in live-action shows like Desperate Housewives, House, and Monk. What was that like?
Actually, that's not true. I've never been an extra.
It says live-action. It says House, female guest number one, Monk, country club lawyer.
Yeah, but those are actual roles. I've only once done some extra work. I think it was in a Drew Barrymore film to get my SAG card or something. But otherwise, all those things that you see here are real roles, either co-star or guest star roles, where you can actually, see me on screen and I play these different roles. That's my very first love. I love doing on-camera work. I think one of my favorite things that I've done recently is I play the mother of a murderer on Criminal Minds, and she was this, I think the murderer was like a teenager, 16, 17 years old, and they lived up in the woods, away from everything, and I think she knew all along that her son was a murderer and she was trying to hide him, and she was kind of abused by her husband. It was sort of a very kind of raw role, but it was just so much fun to play.
Sort of. No. My parents are big, big fans of Criminal Minds. My mom watches it every Wednesday night, so hopefully she's seen you in the episode.
Yeah, I guess so, huh?
She's a real big fan of that, and I will tell her to keep her eye peeled if they do air reruns on CBS or... if we can find it on YouTube somewhere, then I'll send you a link to it. But it was cool. Did you ever get to meet any of the celebrities? Like for Monk, did you ever get to meet Tony Shalhoub?
Tony Shalhoub was the kindest man. I played sort of a snooty, snobby country club lawyer in an episode of Monk. And I'll tell you, we walked on set and there was another guy who was playing a lawyer opposite me, and We had a really nice scene. It was one really nice, long scene, but it wasn't like we had days and days of filming. We just had one day on the set to shoot the scene that was just really fun. And Tony walked up to us and held out his hand and just said, "Hello, my name's Tony." It was so humble and kind. And he just said, "Hello, it's good to meet you. My name's Tony. Welcome to the set." And he looked at me straight in the eye, and he said, "I really appreciate you taking the time today to come be here with us. We care about our show a lot, and it really means a lot that you're here working with us." And it was so kind. And this man is a celebrity. He works every day. He had to be exhausted, and in a way, I'm a dime a dozen, Every day, I'm sure he has people with roles like me who come on the set. And just coming to me with gratitude and that kind of attention and kindness, I hope that if I ever get to be in his position that I will have a quarter as much grace as he does. Just a lovely human being.
I love Monk, and that I'll have to watch the episode. I don't know which episode that was, because it didn't say which one, but it just says Monk, country club lawyer. So, I guess it involves a country club. Maybe one where they go golfing. It might be.
Yes, it's that one. Yeah. I can tell you the name of it. Let me look. I'm just going on IMDb for a second here. Let's see.
Yeah, I am getting a late breaking word they want me to announce that. Yes, indeed. Those are Rouge's boots. They are not feet. They are boots.
That's good to know.
Okay. This has been brought to you by Internet fans. Internet fans! They have no lives.
The name of the episode is Mr. Monk and Sharona, and it's when Sharona makes a guest appearance.
I like Sharona. Natalie, that was okay, but... Sharona had the gray hair. I know that one. It's the one where she comes back and she's in town. She's trying to get settlement, but then they have to prove that it was fake, and they have to. Then they stumble upon a murder case, and then at the end, Sharona trips, and she still gets her lawsuit.
That's it.
All right. And now I know, because knowledge is power. G.I. Joe. One of your better-known characters is Kallen Stadtfeld from Code Geass. What was it like to portray her, and how did you develop her character?
Oh, that was so much fun. That was such a fun show. What was really, really interesting about that show, Kevin Seymour directed that show. And what was really interesting is I never knew what was going to happen in the next episode. So, you know, I never knew what was going to happen with Zero. I never knew whether he was good or bad. I never knew anything ahead of time. Like, sometimes you'll know where the show is going, and many times you won't. But this one, it's just like I would be in the studio that day, and I'd only know what was going on that day. So, like, my experience was purely, you know, that day in the life of Kallen. And I, you know, I'd say to Kevin, I'd be like, what's she going to do? Is she going to turn good? Is she bad? Is she going to fall in love with him? And he'd just look at me and smile. He wouldn't tell me. So I just have to play it for that moment.
Don't you just hate that?
Right.
Hate when they do that, guys. It reminds me of when we had John Cena on the show, and I after the interview, I go, hey, John, I got a question for you. He's like, okay, what? At TLC, did you intentionally fall through that table, or was it an accident? And he looks at me, and he goes, I'll let you be the judge of that. And I'm like, wow. And it's, I'm like, gosh, that was just stupefying. Maybe one of the questions you should have asked is she going to wear clothes today? Because I just, no offense, I just
exactly.
Noticed a lot of nude scenes or a lot of, you know, just bearing it out. It's like where do they develop these characters? Each of them's got
that little Playboy bunny outfit she would just randomly wear.
The bunny outfit, gosh, what else was there?
All those shower scenes that she just happened to be in the shower.
But still, you don't want to mess with her. She will kick your ass.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, gosh, I think she's hot personally. So, but then I got to watch some more of the episode of the show. I hear it's very, very good. I just noticed. I'm starting to see all these pairings with her in Cece. I don't know. She's C2, CC, C squared. It's like, all right, stop with the sex scenes, please. You're ruining the show. Now, we're coming from the College Conservatory of Music here at the University of Cincinnati. We have a lot of vocal majors, theater majors, drama majors. And one of the questions we'd like to ask our voice acting audience is, do you have any advice for those who want to aspire to be voice actors, and any advice on how they should go about making their way into the industry?
Yeah, I could say a couple things. I'd say, first of all, do tons of theater, too. You know, I mean, if you like that, if you don't like that, don't. But theater is just the most wonderful thing, and it really gives you an opportunity to just disappear into a character, you know, and play. So I think that's sort of the base of any kind of acting. There are so many different ways to get into voice acting, you know, and so many different people I know have gotten into it in so many different ways. You know, like me, I'd never even taken a voiceover. I'd been doing theater since I was a very little girl because I loved it. But I had never taken a voiceover class, and I just started doing it. You know, I think, you know, and then some people like to take classes. I think a really fantastic thing to do is just start playing on your own at home. You know, start making up voices. And, you know, everybody has an iPhone these days or something you can tape with, or your Mac or something. You know, just start making up voices and putting them on tape, you know, and create a collection of voices. And, you know, now so much is available. I mean, you can go online and you can hear different people's voiceover reels. I mean, you can just find so much online. And I think you can imitate other people if you like the voices that they do. When I first started out, there was in Paris, I heard this woman, when I was working on this thing called Hi Kids, there was this woman named Mimi Seaton, and she was doing little boy voices, and it was just fantastic. And she'd sit there in the studio, and I would look at her, and she would, like, turn into a little boy, and she'd gesticulate with her fist, and, you know, she just turned into this little tomboy, and she was this grown woman. And I thought, that is the coolest thing. I want to learn to do that. And I would go home, and I would, you know, remember what she was doing, and I would, you know, learn to do it on my own just because I thought what she was doing was so cool. And I think that's one of the best ways to learn is just to go home and start playing around, you know? Oh, I love this voice that this person does. Let me try and do a voice like that and play. I mean, to me, it is just, it's so much about play. And then there's all kinds of, you know, there's all kinds of ways if you want to start getting professional experience. You know, I think that there's a lot of schools out there and people who are looking for people who will do jobs for free. You know, there's schools, probably even at your school, there's people who have animation projects. And you can do projects for them for free. You know, see where you can volunteer, find out, and just start getting experience. I think the more, if you're really, really serious about it and you want to really get into the industry, I think the more you can just get out there and say, you know, do radio plays with people and record it and, you know, find, you know, animation schools, people who are creating, students who are creating, you know, animation and say, hey, you know, I'll do voices for you for free. And start, you know, just offering up your services. And I think the more kind of experience you can get in front of a mic and playing, you know, the more comfortable you'll be when you start to really get into a professional arena.
I got a question. Is that Hi Kids, are they related at all to Hi Lights magazine?
No, but it was the same. It's a little bit later than that era. It's like 15 years after Hi Lights came out, I'd say. But it's a French thing. It's sort of, I'd say it's kind of the same thing, but they're not related.
Those finding the picture of puzzles just got me every time.
Hey there, this is Brock, Pewter City gym leader and Pokemon breeder. And this is the All Taste Explosion with the Boogaloo Shrimp, featuring John Pokemon.
Right now, let's go ahead. We actually got our first listener question. So, are you ready, Karen?
I'm ready.
Okay. Our first two questions come from Cedric Smith. How did you come up with the voice of Sui Ginto in Rosen Maiden?
Hey, Cedric. That was fun. I was working with Alex on that, and I guess I auditioned for it. We wanted something that was very evil, but very sort of sexy and sweet at the same time. And, just played around with a couple of things and kind of, that's where we ended up. She's very creepy. I really enjoyed doing her.
Creepy's an understatement. And all those black feathers going everywhere. She just seems like, She's the stereotype that doll's eyes can creep you out. I think she's the reason that stereotype is still standing today, ladies and gentlemen. Gosh, and when I heard it for the first time, it took everything in me to refrain from doing a Rent joke. Because she says that number of hours since we met, I don't know, what was it, 500-something hours? And then you bust out. What? I'm sorry?
Yeah.
You bust out, how do you measure a year in the light? Yeah, so that was a Rent movie joke. That was, not many people would get it, but I get it, and that's all that matters.
I get it.
All right, thank you. Someone gets my jokes. A guest on the show gets my jokes. Who'd have thunk it? Okay, his next question is, how did you come up with the voice for Miyuki Tanako in When They Cry, and he has a request. He wants to know, would you say in her voice, did you bury the body?
Hmm. Let's see if I can find her voice again. That was another really interesting show, because I worked with Tony on that, and you know, there were so many different, you know, there were so many different endings, because in each set of episodes, you know, they all ended differently, and each character kind of played a different role. So each time there was like a different side of her revealed, and sometimes she was just really innocent, and then sometimes, you know, you saw a darker side of her. And I to this day, you know, I don't know what is the truth about her, you know, and how much she really had to do with everything and how much she didn't. I would be very happy to do voices for you guys. This particular one, I'm afraid I'd disappoint you because I haven't heard it for a long time. I'd have to listen to it in order to get it right, and I'm afraid if I tried to do it, I would be off mark with it, and I wouldn't get it right.
That's cool. I'm sure Cedric would understand. I'm sure he would be cool with it. You know, it's one of those unique shows. Rebecca, when we had her on, she even said that was an odd show. Just little kids killing each other. It's like,
yeah.
What? And I'm sorry. It had me going, what the f***? I am just, yeah. My jaw is dropped. My right side of my brain shuts down so the left side can catch up with it. I'm watching this little blue-haired girl take a knife and stab herself in the throat.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, what? What? Is this a dream? That show. I'm going to say this. I'm going to make a joke. Tom Cruise saw that show and went on antidepressants. I know a Tom Cruise joke. That's again the king of obscure references. But again, you know, beggars can't be choosers, especially in today's economy. It's a paying gig. So you bite the bullet and you do it.
Oh, well, yeah, and I also worked with some really cool people on that show. I worked with Tony directed it, Tony Oliver, and he's just so wonderful.
Oh, Tony Oliver, he's fantastic.
We had so much fun just working together, you know. So sometimes there's just, you know, even if the show you're like, okay, this isn't my favorite show, but this is kind of interesting, and this character is kind of interesting, and gosh, I love working with Tony, you know? So,
Tony's got some skills on him, I'll tell you what.
A little bit.
Not only is he a producer, a great voice actor, it's amazing that these guys are like the Swiss pocket knives of anime.
You know,
you got him, you got Wendy Lee, she also writes, she directs, she ADRs. It's amazing all she can do, and of course I'm not selling you short either, Karen. You've got a very, very, very diverse role of characters, and a lot of them have just made me say, "Wow."
Hmm.
Okay, Cedric says, "If you can't do Armio, could you do it? Could you give us a little Sui Ginto?"
Oh, Cedric, I could do that for you if you'd like.
And the temperature of the Jack and Jones Shredder studio, part of the Electronic Media Division of CCM, just dropped 20 degrees. Gosh, these dolls they're taking over my show. I'll tell you what I got a problem with. Sui Sei Seki, I got a problem with these little brownie dolls. They think they have all these magic powers. I want to remind them of something. They are f***ing dolls. They are no bigger than Barbie dolls, and they can easily be punt kicked. So, again, listen to me yelling at a cartoon character. I'm winning. We are having so much fun here on the show tonight. Oh, boy. Okay, another listener question we got is, could we get Miyuki's opinion on which side of a Choco Cornet is the head, the fat end or the skinny end?
Well, let me see.
2 years later.
It really depends on how you define the head, because if you start from the bottom and eat your way to the top, then the bottom becomes the first part, and if you turned it upside down, then that would be the head. But if you started on the top and licked from the top, well, then I suppose that would be the head. So it would be very, very difficult to make that decision. I suppose I'd have to think about it.
Okay. Hey, again, at least you're not trash talking me. I thank you for that, Miyuki. Thank you so much. I still have no idea. Even when we ask Konata, no one explains, what is a Chaco Cornet? I'm Googling it, and all I'm getting is more Jim Cornette references. And no, there's not going to be Jim Cornette reference in this interview. I promise you that.
You know, a lot of things in the wrestling world make me cranky these days. Especially the way that some talent is treated and some talent is looked at by not only the promoters, but the wrestling fans as well. For example, guys like the NWO, the New World Order. You know, all the fans think these guys are so cool and so sweet and so funny. Well, as far as I'm concerned, the NWO is like a bunch of guys meeting out in the backyard in a clubhouse in a tree.
Hey, boy. We're getting some more questions. Okay, here's one. They want to remain anonymous. I don't know why, but could you give us a little Kallen Stadtfeld?
Yeah.
Hang on. Let me let me do something. I don't know if you heard. I did a little faux news report in the beginning of the interview. I want to see if maybe we can bring that right back up. Let's see. Can we? Welcome back. We have got more breaking news. As we reported earlier in the show, the Britannian government had just announced that Ashford Academy student Kallen Stadtfeld has been believed to have ties with the radical group the Black Knights, an organization known for its plans to overthrow the Britannian Empire. Joining us now live via phone, we have got Kallen Stadtfeld. Kallen, what is your answer to these ludicrous statements?
Well, Dennis, I don't know. I've been sworn to secrecy, and anything I tell you might change anyway.
Secrecy? What do you mean secrecy? And what are these rumors going around that your actual last name is Kozaki?
You know, really, Dennis, I'm just a student at this school, so I wouldn't know anything about it. And, you know, my health is poor. If you'll excuse me, I'm going to go do some cosplay.
Kallen, it sounds like you are dodging the questions. Is it true that you have connections to the Notorious Zero? Who is he? What is he about? Which side is up? I do not know. You are the only one who has the answers to these questions, and we need to know now!
I don't even know who Zero is. I don't know who you're talking about. I'm sorry, I can't help you.
What do you have to say to the report that you have been sided with several notorious members of the Black Knights?
No comment.
Answer the question! You're flip-flopping!
All I can say is, they better be careful.
Is that a threat?
Nothing. I have a class to get to, so I'm sorry, Dennis. I have to go.
Kallen! Why are they always doing this? They're always doing this. Well, ladies and gentlemen, as you can see, we have gotten zero answers about zero. Now back to your regularly scheduled program. We should submit that to the Mashable Award. That was funny. That was fun. That's fun. That's F-U-N-H funny. Oh gosh, even the fans are going LMAO. Oh boy, this was I haven't had this much fun in a very long time.
What does LMAO mean?
Laughing my ass off.
Ah, that's great.
I mean, I can't laugh mine off because it's still there. I know, a fat joke. Wow, I'm depressed. Another question we got. Okay, not a voice act request. So, where are you going to be at the next convention? Are you got any conventions coming up?
I'm not sure yet. Right now, I don't have any planned. Honestly, I don't do as many conventions as my colleagues do. I guess I'm a little more of a hermit. But I will. I don't have one yet, but I'm going to have a Facebook site coming up I guess in the next month or two, with all my fan information and stuff. So as soon as I know about that, you know, don't start looking now. I think there's like some fans that have made a Facebook site, but it's not, I don't have anything to do with it. But in like 2 months or maybe even a month or so, I'll have a Facebook site up and I'll start putting all that information up so people can start looking for that in a little while.
And we will have a link to that on the All Taste Explosion website at alltasteexplosion.com. And of course, we'll have a link to your website as well, KarenStrassman.com. If anybody out there is looking for a great voice, you know, point, 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 point. Jeez, I just, again, and we're getting a, Cedric says that was LMFAO, picking myself up off the floor. Oh boy, this, this one's going to give me the Bearcast Award for sure. Well, is there anything that you would like to bring to your public, to your general public that you maybe want to talk about? Is there an issue you feel like deserves some kind of notice? And we'll turn the mic over to you. Is there something you'd like to talk about?
Gosh, I'm not a very political or issue oriented person. I think that my experience in my own voiceover career has just been about, you know, people helping each other and being kind. Mm-hmm. And I think that the world is so crazy right now, and I think that we're all under so much stress, and I think that's why I'm so grateful for what I do, because we get to entertain people and it's fun. But I think, you know, there's a lot of stress and, you know, a lot of hard stuff going on in the world right now. It's kind of, there's a lot of turmoil, and I think as much as we can be kind to each other and, you know, help each other when we can, I think sometimes we all get so stressed that we forget that. It's a very simple, maybe naive message, but that's the thing that comes to mind to say. And I think that any success that I have had, a lot of it is just because of, you know, people giving me an opportunity and being kind to me, you know, and believing in me, you know. And I think the other thing that I just want to say to all of you guys is I just do this because I love it. And I never imagined that I would have fans or that people would, you know, track down what I do. And I'm very, very flattered by that. You guys are awesome. And I'm just really grateful for all your support, you know. And I hope that everybody listening, you know, listen to your dreams and follow them. Believe in them and follow them, you know. Say that too.
We got a comment from Fantesca, and Fantesca says, I really liked you as Yuzuki and Chobits. I liked it much. I made a unique brand of cosplay to go with it.
Wow.
He's actually, they actually got on their Facebook page, they got a picture of, now my friend told me about this. It's called Kigurumi. And this guy, I believe it's a guy, I'm not sure, but he's actually made a mask of Yuzuki.
Fantastic.
It's Fantesca. Doo-doo-doo. I know. Oh, I am so clever tonight.
Maybe you can put it up at the radio station site or something.
Well, I'll send you an email to the photo. He's a friend of mine. And
oh, cool.
And he asks, would you give us a little bit of Yuzuki?
Chobits. Oh, my goodness. God, that was so long ago.
I mean, if you can't, it's totally cool, you know? I'm not going to hold a knife to your head and say, do it. I'm not an animal like that, folks.
Some of these I'd need to hear again. And be like, the second I'd hear it, I'd be like, oh, and then I could do it for you.
Right, let's go to the demo reel, kiddies.
Welcome to our home. How do you do? My name is Yuzuki.
So you would be Mr. Kokobunji's elder sister?
Oh, no. I'm a Persicom who was custom built by Lord Minoru.
They give you enough of...
Oh my gosh, I love her. Welcome to our home. My name is Yuzuki.
Woo! Yuzuki! 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 I like her. She's hot. I don't care if she's a robot, android, cyborg.
Oh, she's very hot.
When I saw her, I was like, That can't be a robot. And then she pulls the cord out of her, like, son of a bitch, she's a robot. Man, the Japanese are getting more and more advanced. Gosh, that show was just, it was amazing. Where are them in our future? It's 2000, still no flying cars, and they got robots. I'm in the wrong country. But speaking of Japan, are you we talked to a lot of voice actors, and they're doing a lot to raise awareness of the disaster that occurred in Japan about 2 months ago. And are you doing anything special to help raise awareness?
I don't think I'm doing anything politically. I think that we talk a lot amongst people, and, you know, we're all giving to charities and everything. And Stephanie Shea just did this amazing event that was just fantastic that a lot of people were at. I think the thing that I have to say about what's going on in Japan is just reading, you know, talking to friends who have friends who are there, and, you know, reading all of the stories about it, I'm kind of in awe of how the Japanese people are living it with such honor, and they're really taking care of one another. And, you know, I think that the Japanese culture, one of their, you know, I think different cultures, we all have different values, which are sometimes more prominent in some cultures than others. And I think that, you know, one of the qualities that's very prominent in the Japanese culture is honor. And honor involves, you know, taking care of your family. It involves, you know, reaching out and make sure others are fed. I mean, I've heard stories about how there are, like, you know, like candy machines and soda pop machines, you know, in the streets of the towns that have been bombed. And there are people without food and drink, you know. And I think in America, people would have just, you know, hacksawed into those things or hammered their way into them and stolen whatever they could. And apparently, you know, from what I've heard, you know, those vendor machines, they're just, nobody's touched them, you know, out of honor. You don't do that. And it just sounds like there's a sense of really taking care of each other and of, you know, coming from that place. And, you know, I live in Los Angeles, and sometimes I wonder, you know, here or other places, if, you know, what it would, if it would look like that, you know. And it's really made me think about, you know, about how we could and should react if a disaster happened, you know, and how to take care of each other. I think we all get so scared, and all of a sudden it's just each man for his own. And I've been thinking a lot about that quality of honor and, you know, taking care of those around you. And I think that it's something that we can learn a lot from. And I think that we can really learn a lot from the Japanese right now in how they're handling these situations. And in some ways, they are very much in need of help and support. But it's very interesting. In other ways, they are a living example, and I think that we should really observe them. And there's a lot to be learned for how they're living the situation.
I know it's easy to forget about the whole Japanese incident, and there are a lot of things we joke about on the show. But one thing we cannot joke about is the plight that the Japanese are in. This is not something that's just going to clean itself up. It's not going to go away just like that. This is going to be a work in progress. It's going to take years among years to get Japan to back to where it is. So that's why I say this. And I got, ladies and gentlemen, I've said this once, I've said it a million bajillion times, I've said it over 9,000 times, over 9,000. Japan needs our help. You know, you don't have to just give money. You can give time, you can give energy, you can give love. Just that they know that someone over here cares a lot about them and about their plight. You know, that's a lot to get people through. And we just can't sweep this under the broom like Katrina, where it's every man for himself. We need to come together as a country, as a globe, and help out the country that has given us culture, art, anime, a talk show that I can have guests like Karen and Wendy Lee and Vic Mignogna and Eric Stewart and everyone on here. So please, look into your heart. Give generously to your American Red Cross. I'm Dennis Daniel, and I like pie. I know it's really tough to think about another country that's in need, especially since we're still in a bit of a recession. But if we don't do something, it's not going to get better. It's not like you can just sweep this under the rug and it's going to be done. It's not going to be gone.
I think every little bit helps. You know, I think people think if they don't give a lot, then it's not worth anything. But I think if many, many people just give a little, then it turns into a lot.
Yes, and if you're not down with that, I got two words for you. Help out. It wasn't going to be suck it, so. All right, Karen, I got one final question, and I know you're probably tired after a long day of kicking ass and voice acting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, dominating that, you know, because that's what you do, because I've seen a lot of stuff, and you just tear the roof off. You know, tear it off, kick its butt, and kick it to the curb of, like, epicness. And, well, you've left a legacy that's transcended time. A lot of countless characters. If they're bats in boots that look kind of weird to creepy dolls that could actually kick a grown man's ass by holding through the finger and making the magic go. You've done shy characters. You've done shy-looking characters that can really kick a guy's butt. You've done people with French accents. You've done movies. You've done Meg Ryan in French with American accent, which we're going to try to find that. I want to see what that is like. It's got to be crazy. Do you feel like you've left quite a legacy in anime and or overall in your voice acting career?
I don't think that's for me to say. I don't know. I think that's for you all to decide. I just hope that I'm just flattered that people enjoy some of what I do and that it brings people some fun. And I'm just flattered by that. And if there is a legacy, then I'm flattered by that too. I just feel really lucky to get to do what I do.
And
I never really even thought about being famous or having a legacy. So the fact that people like my work and that there are fans who, you know, are listening to the show and that you even want me on this show, I'm humbled by it and I'm flattered by it. And I think that's thanks to all of you.
I'm the one who should be flattered and humbled that you would take time out of your very, very busy schedule, you know, to come here, to come on the phone, you know, or sit next to the couch with me, you know, give an hour, hour and a half of your time to talk to a goofy, wacky anime fan with a lot of hair and he needs to get cut off of his head because it's turning into a bush. And I'm honored and I'm thrilled and I thank you from the deepest part of my heart. I'm standing up. I'm giving you a standing ovation. It's just me, the wacky clapping in the podcast. We're making some magic here, folks, and hopefully you will be able to come back on the show real soon with any new projects you're working on. If you got something you want plugged, we'd be more than happy to plug it on our show. And I know this does not sum up all the happiness in my heart, but all I can say, Karen, is thank you.
It was really fun. Thank you, Dennis.
Thank you. And again, check out that's KarenStrassman.com. Is it KarenStrassman.com?
My website or my email?
Website.
Website, yes.
KarenStrassman.com. We're going to have a link to it on the Altate Explosion webpage. Karen Strassman, thank you so much for being on the show. We'll be back real soon with another great guest. This has been the Dennis Daniel Show. Until next time, good night, everybody!